Hello.
Okay, just one last word, so to repeat it for the record, because actually it goes on the recording. Isabel just pointed out, so we have these brochures, which is actually the print version of the talk I just gave, with nice little pictures, so please take them and spread the word. Yeah, thank you very much.
Good morning. First, of course, I would like to thank the organization. And well, I'm presenting myself. I'm Pedro. As Max was saying, I'm an electrical engineer. I did a PhD in artificial intelligence, trying to teach machines to understand music and feel music as humans. I'm also a failed musician. And 6 years ago, I started a company together with some colleagues at the university. This is a spin-off from the UPF University. And we basically do services and we provide technology to the music industry. We are not extremely successful, but we've managed to put our technology in over 50 countries. We have customers in 4 continents, and it's from labels, publishers, performing rights organizations, and music services. This is one of the examples of the things that we do. This is the Voice of Korea, same as the Voice of America. It's here we provide a software where you can sing, and the computer will tell if you're singing good or bad. It will basically say if you're singing in tune, and well, it will provide you a tuning and also an expression based on if you put in a vibrato and the kind of thing you do. The second thing that we do, is also as Max was saying, we have machines listening to the radios and TVs all over the world, and we create ratings. We basically want to listen with everything that is aired, music-wise, 24 hours, and this information we then provide to several agents in the music industry, but mainly to the performing rights organizations. Performing rights organizations are responsible for distributing $10 billion dollars yearly to composers, performers, and producers. In order for them to do it properly, we create these playlists of everything that is being aired. And finally, the topic of this talk, which is music recommendation, playlist generation, music discovery. This is an example of one of the how it looks like when you have a music discovery service, and this is Singapore Telco music service, and you can put artists, album, songs, and it either suggests you similar songs or creates a playlist for you. Now, the topic of this talk is how, but with what we have tried to do with complex networks to improve music recommendation. So first, let me start with music recommenders. What is the need? In a service like Samsung, or any other that are there, it's 19 million tracks. That's more music than anybody can listen in their whole life. So one of the things that are useful, same as Google indexes the web, is to have something that indexes the music for you. Another interesting aspect is to have something that can take you to the long tail. There's this Chris Anderson article about the long tail and how small selling artists could be profitable in the digital world.
Sorry.
No?
You need some light for the video.
Ah, okay.
So I was trying to calibrate so that you have enough understanding there.
Stop.
It doesn't stop, it's on and off.
On the controller up on the podium, there's a button that says like computer under the separate lights.
Thank you so much. You suffered already then, yes. I think
room
I appreciate
is a
it. Yeah?
Okay.
Sorry,
Pedro.
No, it's fine, it's fine. I will do the same when you come to Barcelona. What's
I'm just trying to make your slides more readable.
They're very, very dark, I guess, huh? That's fine, huh?
Okay.
Yeah? Thank you. Well, as I was saying, well, one of the benefits of the digital is that you could have a lot of music, as I said, almost not more than 20 million tracks, so that a very small artist in a distant country can sell its music worldwide and maybe live as a musician, while if he would have to sell physical in his local town, city, that would not be possible. But the reality is that only 1% of the tracks account for 80% of the sales, which is, I think, expected in the part of it. But a lot of tracks, they just sell less than 100 copies. Of course, you cannot make a living based on that. So one of the things that we want to aim with the Music Recommender is to really be able to exploit the long tail and be able for anybody to find the music and connect artists and music and its music with the consumers. Now, what are the types of recommenders out there? There are basically four things that are four approaches for music recommendation. One is the expert-based, and here what you have, it's editors that tell you that well, this artist has these members and it's similar to this other. This is humans that have a broad musical knowledge that put these links. Another alternative is collaborative filtering, which is exploiting the word of mouth. If I like, tend to listen to this artist, and this other person tends to listen to very similar artists plus some that I don't know, it's very likely that I might like these other artists. And these have been quite successful, not only in music, but of course in Amazon and some other recommender engines. The third one is context, which is looking at the music itself, looking for everything that might be relevant. So if we're talking about an artist, we can go and look for the biography, we can see which are the composers, we can see which are the musicians that they play with, what is the popularity in MySpace or in YouTube, and so on. This is an example for Jamiroquai. He would say, no, that he's from UK. The labels where he has been, where he has recorded, the genres that are associated, the years where he was active, but also the associated acts. This is something that gives you information of the type of music. And the last one, it's content-based. That is the only one that actually looks at the music itself. This is the approach that Pandora, for instance, does, and they basically describe the audio, describe the music, then for recommendation. What we have done in the university, and we also do in the company, is to do this automatically, which is more scalable. And we are able to do analysis like this one. Here on top, you would have the audio signal. The audio signal goes through a Fourier type of a spectrum and analysis, and that puts the energy bin in each semitone. So in here, you have the semitones. So it's like a spectrogram for semitones, which is then correlated with profiles of chords, and you end up having here the sequence of chords.
On a dark desert highway, cool wind in my hair,
F major.
One smell of calitas rising up through the air. Up ahead in the distance, I saw a shimmering light.
So this is one kind of analysis that it's done at the tonal level, but there's many more at the rhythmical to say whether the song is happy or not. And I'll give you some example of some of the things. This is a demo, but the analysis is real. Here you're able to say that mood is upbeat and energetic, which is what is the rhythm. There are no tensions in the rhythm, it's a stable one. Highly percussive, D minor, there's the presence of the singing voice. And with this kind of information, we can recommend music with similar characteristics. Okay, so now we have music recommenders, why we need them, and the basic approaches. And what I will be presenting now is what we have borrowed from complex networks to better understand music recommendation systems and try to improve them. So this is this is Last.fm. This is a very famous recommendation network, and what you can have is the Beatles and the different artists that it's similar to, that it's related to. So we have, this is very obvious how we have constructed the network, but we have connected the artists when there is a recommendation. Okay, so what we have done is, well, we actually did this in the past. We did it for four music recommendations, which were the most important at the time, and which were LaunchAHue, Amazon, Microsoft Network, and AllMusicGuide. If we have to do it now, we would choose different ones. And we applied different complex networks, topological measures. And this is the findings. I will go very fast. Then, of course, it's a small world, which is no surprise. But it's good in a music recommendation system because the networks are quite big. The first one, Microsoft Network, there was 50,000 artists. And to be able to move in a such a big network in a small number of steps, that's a good thing to have. Of course, the other good thing is that the small networks have good navigation properties. Not only that you can move from any point to any other point in the network, eventually being able to exploit the long tail, but also that you can do it in a meaningful manner. Regarding the degree distribution, we have plotted here for the different systems, and we observe two type of behaviors. One is for these two on the left, that they show a power law, and the ones on the right, the x-axis is on a linear, they're exponential. What is this? Well, the ones on the left, I did not introduce them, but they're based on collaborative filtering, one of these fourth measures, methods for recommendation. And the last two are expert-based, and they show an exponential degree. So we were trying to understand why collaborative filtering produces scale-free, and the expert, the editors, produce exponentials. So, and also we came across this article where it basically, in this, you would have a number of music which was not famous, and you would have humans saying whether they like it or not. This is one setup. In the other setup, the music was rated, but when you would rate the music, you could see what the other users had rated before. The experiment showed that if you could see what the others had done, there was a lot more inequality and unpredictability in the music success. Normally, the music was the same that was selected as most liked or better quality or whatever, but how unequal, how heterogeneous this was done was a lot bigger if it was in a social scheme. We tried to see something similar, and we gathered data from MusicSeer in which humans would put for a particular artist, which are the similar ones, and Art of the Mix, which used to be one of the biggest playlist repositories on the web with more than 500,000 playlists. And doing the analysis, we could see that the humans saying that this is similar to something produces an exponential degree distribution in the recommendation network, whereas Art of the Mix, which is could be the basis of a collaborative filtering algorithm because you're putting music together in a playlist, produces scale-free. So I used to say that collaborative filtering networks are scale-free because of a popularity bias, something like there's a reinforcement. I don't dare to say that much anymore because I've been said that it was wrong many times. I don't know what is the reason. Maybe it's could be a popularity thing, or because it's a social network and it has some sort of a feedback loop that makes scale-free degrees appear, whereas the human-supervised networks are exponential. Now, this is another experiment that we did, and here we were trying to compare music similarity with social music networks. Now, the need for us is that the music similarity, if it's a human editor that needs to connect artists, is a very expensive thing to do. in the systems that we manage. It's like 1 million artists. If we need to connect 1 million artists against each other, that's a lot of work. So we wanted to see whether the social musicians, how musicians have played together, could be a proxy of this. So what we did is to use AllMusic, which is one of the biggest repositories for this kind of information, and compare the collaboration network, which is factual data, data that we can see that it's in the label copy in the CD, with the similarity network, which is more expensive and something that you need to do by hand and by experts, and then this is similar to this other. And I will not go into details, but what we could see, well, first, just some comments. And there we go. The haps in the similarity network at the moment were Eric Clapton, Sting, REM, while at the collaboration network it was Paulo da Costa, which is a, I don't know if Isabel, you, it's a musician, it's a Brazilian musician with a lot of collaborations among not only Brazilian but also jazz. It's a very, well, a lot of collaborations. What we could see is that the collaboration is, was this, without looking whether this, how we could draw this data and put it into the similarity, was that the, at least from the degree distribution, this was already different from the similarity one, which, as we said before, the similarity was exponential, and this collaboration is scale-free, which is. The other thing that we did was to look at the community structure. We used the Girvan-Newman algorithm, and we applied it to the two networks, the similarity and the collaboration network. And well, after splitting, what we observed was in the similarity, the communities that appear are mostly based on genre, so which makes all the sense. You're connecting artists, and the fact that they have a same genre is similar. But the collaboration one, the one that we wanted to use as a proxy for music recommendation, it does not. Nothing like that at all. And well, we were looking at the, it makes sense that you tend to do collaborations cross genre. And you want to mix things to do fusion. If you're successful, then you put one artist and then another one which has nothing to do, you know, a rap singer with Christina Aguilera or whatever. So even though it was fun and useful, it's not easy to derive this kind of information to use it for similarity. This is another thing that we applied, which is, sorry for going too fast, identifying the roles from community structures. As you have seen, most of the things that we did was to steal or borrow things from complex networks literature to see how it could help us better understand the data and the problems that we had at hand. And in this case, it's trying to, by looking at the topology, to see what are the roles of different nodes. And well, you can, I will not go into details, but you can classify the nodes based on whether they're very central in their community or whether they're more connected to other communities. And well, when we apply this to the SoundLike community, well, we have, this is very small, but I will try to. So we have the communities which are mostly genre-based. In the center, the haps are, like for instance, in the rock one, we have here Joni Mitchell and James Taylor. But the haps which are connecting to others, in here in the rock you have Eric Clapton, who's connecting rock with jazz or rock with blues. Or you have here Bowie in the rock, which is connecting the rhythm and blues and to hard rock. This, well, was only funny if you like music, but it was also relevant. It is relevant for the, when you try to devise playlist generation. And if you use Pandora or Last.fm, you can start a playlist by saying the name of a song or the name of an artist. And then it's like a random walk in a music similarity network where you go to similar songs or similar artists. And this is how you create the radio station. Now, if you start in Joni Mitchell, it's okay as long if you stay around here, but you have to be careful that if you jump into Eric Clapton in two, three steps, you might end up anywhere, but not where you might maybe want to be. The final thing is how far, these music recommender engines, how far do they go into the long tail? And in this case, we compare Last.fm, and we compare with our recommendation engine, but only using the content. Our algorithm, it's a hybrid. We use everything collaborative context content, but for this experiment, we only used the content recommendation. So this is the Last.fm data set that was the basis for the thing that we did then also for the content. It had over 250,000 artists. And in here, what you see is the artists ranked by the number of play counts. Here you have the 10 most played artists. Can you see? The Beatles, Radiohead, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Muse, Pink Floyd, Coldplay, and Metallica. We model it with a Kilkey model, and these eight most played artists are responsible for 3.5% of the plays. If we divide it, then the head of the long tail, the mid tail, and the tail, you see that you have in the head 82 artists, then in the mid 6,000, and at the tail 250,000. This is just a cross-check. We wanted to see what the Last.fm, it's a mixture of collaborative filtering and context. So that's collaborative filtering, what the users rate and what how they behave, plus some data on genre, city of origin of the artist, decade of playing, and so on. But you can see is that the artists in degree in the music recommendation network, how happy they are in the music recommendation network, is highly correlated to the artist popularity. That is how many times they get played on Last.fm. Meanwhile, when we do the same thing for the content-based, it's up here. You can see there's almost no correlation whether you have a hub or not in the content-based is not related at all with the popularity. This is something to go back to the point that we were saying before, that maybe collaborative filtering are very biased to popularity, whereas the content base, nothing at all. But then the question is, in how many clicks can you go from a famous artist into a long tailer one, which is one of the things that we want to do. We want to make all the music in the world available. So let me put another video with the older version. Okay, so what you're seeing here is this is the old interface. This is when we were back at the university, and this is the seed song. So we use Better Days by Bruce Springsteen. And then what it displays is similar songs based on this, looking only at the audio. It doesn't look what the other users think or the context or anything, just the audio itself. First recommendation. So you have there three recommendations. The first one is Bruce Springsteen, is of course very famous. The recommended one was the Rolling Stone, which is also very famous. But the third one had only 577 plays, which is Mike Sharp, which is this guy over here. And you cannot recommend this with collaborative filtering. That was like a good point for content-based, but then the other thing that we wanted to see was how easy it is to go from the head to the mid or to the tail. We did a model to see how, with doing an average, if you're in the collaborative filtering, meaning Last.fm or in a purely content-based one, to go from the head to tail. And the probability to end up in tail with more than 0 point probability, the number of clicks you need for the collaborative filtering is 5, and in the content-based is 2. Of course, always knowing where you need to go. But okay, and then the other thing that we did was just compare how the normal humans, how they like it better, the content-based or the collaborative filtering. I will not go into details. We used either Last.fm. We would take your Last.fm profile. We would recommend you songs, and then you the users would rate. This was done, I think, with 280 users. It's not a huge experiment, but it was quite controlled. And the overall results are that the users, I will skip this, they all prefer collaborative filtering. So the recommendations that they get with collaborative filtering are preferred over content-based or the hybrid approach. Which is not a surprise. Sometimes with content-based, you can start in heavy metal from Spain and you end up in a Norwegian band, or in a, if you have flamenco, you can have then some volcanic music, which is not related at all, but it's related in by the acoustic of it. And a normal user might not understand what is going on. So to summarize, then the systems that perform the best by how the users like it, collaborative filterings do not really exploit the long tail. While the system that can easy and navigate and take you to the long tail do not perform good. So what we like to do in the future is how to combine these different approaches to have the best of the two worlds. And with this, I finish. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Pedro. I think this raises a lot of interesting questions, I guess, right? So please go ahead.
I have a very quick question. I wonder from your last examples, did you remove the super nodes from your recommendation, especially from the collaborative filtering recommendation at some point, like the most popular artist or song? Did you remove them from your...
You mean from the user evaluation?
Yeah, from the algorithms.
No.
That would be a good idea to do that sometimes, you know, to move the people more towards the long tail.
Well, in the experiment, actually, you would compare. In the experiment, when they had to see whether they like it or not, you would check whether you know the artist and the song. You would know only the artist but not the song, or whether the song was completely unknown. So for the unknown is where you're actually having something which is new and unique. And this either comes from the head, mid, long tail or not, depending on, but it's in this unknown, this that you have a 3 in here, and in the unknown for the content-based, which is bigger in the serendipity or the uncertainty of the recommendation, but you have a lower score. If you are in the same artist, if the person knows the artist and the song, for the content-based and the collaborative filtering, there was not much of a difference. It's when you go crazy. It's when you really go to the long tail that something can.
Okay, so I ask the next question. Please say your name and where you're from. Would be very nice. The last question was by Burak, who is one of our keynotes. So.
Thank you very much. Hiroki Sayama from Binghamton University, SUNY. Very interesting work, thank you. So my question is about how much randomness you should include in the content-based recommendation system. Because if I were the musician who are the struggling in the long tail, you know, I would tend to copy the popular music genre, which may not necessarily be the healthy thing. So you always want to have some sort of serendipity kind of the discovery. So are you using any random recommendation as part of the content-based?
No. I mean, besides the mistake that the algorithms include by themselves,
yeah,
no.
Yeah.
No. But I don't know. I mean, if I were an artist, I would try to differentiate. If you already have something which is similar to something, I don't know. I don't know. Over the years, I've seen that these things do not really, and know more of the music industry the audio and the music itself is a small part of the whole thing. I mean, it matters more is your looks and your how beautiful or handsome you are, and your how good at marketing. But then you have examples like Adele or I don't know Amy Winehouse or things that happen that are success based mostly on. But I think it's because they do something different and new themselves. Don't need.
I guess I had a sort of a follow-up to Burek's question. My name is Ben Pimenpaletta from Harvard Medical School. But I guess I was just thinking, this question sort of touched on this too, that there is probably in addition to, I mean, there are probably, you know, certain reasons that some people end up in the long tail and some don't. And I guess I was just thinking that it would make sense. You don't really have a way of telling what those reasons are besides popularity, unfortunately. But if you can control for that, that might be sort of helpful. In other words, I guess the collaborative filtering, they tend to sort of weed out. I mean, there's a selection of sort of popular songs, which may be popular for a reason besides that just they are popular.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
So I guess that is more of a comment than a question, but. But just something to think about. Maybe we can talk about it later. But I'm curious if you had any ideas about how you might combine the two, just off the cuff, that you were thinking of.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Barry Holden from NY Art Projects in New York. Just a question that I guess, sort of like a Google search, doesn't familiarity propel the popularity and vice versa, and in a sense that has very little to do with the music? In other words, it's another whole system. Is there a way to filter that out? You follow what I'm saying?
To remove familiarity?
The connections are also done when you ask people about, you know, what was familiar, etc. Isn't that, was it just the music? Was familiarity, or was it the fact that it had been played many, many times and they had heard it many, many times?
You're talking about the music here?
Yeah. Back a few slides. Right. I mean, does that have to do with the music itself, or is it a separate sort of issue that familiarity and, you know, popularity is...
Really, but if we look here in the unknown and you don't know at all the music... the artist and the song, then I would say it filters out the familiarity. At least okay. You don't know the music and the song. I don't know if I understood.
Maybe I can clarify a little bit. So I think the question is if it's the so-called, you know, there's this biggest threat of mankind right now is the filter bubble, right? So basically Google enabling a social kind of frame where you only search within your own neighborhood, right? And basically this thing is like, if you're exposed to mainstream radio stations for 20 years or 30 years of your life, the selection bucket where you would choose songs from is actually the stuff you have heard for 30 years. So the question is, probably that's an unsolvable question. Could we imagine a world where people have not listened to mainstream radio stations, and would then the result look different? Is that making a point?
Yeah. It has sort of nothing to do with music in a way. It's to do with that you're familiar with the thing itself, and therefore you choose it.
Yeah, but that's beyond. That's I don't know if I'm getting.
It's a feedback loop, right? Yeah. Taking place there.
But you're talking about in what the us in this room like, that we are modified by the music that we have been exposed to, or the algorithm? I mean, who's been filtered, or who's behaving strangely? In the algorithm, we can remove everything about popularity. That's feasible. But whether the people in this room will like it or not, that's not. The reality is that it depends on the service. If, like, for instance, one of the music recommendations that we do is for publishers, say EMI. EMI has 1 million songs, and they have to sell them to a commercial. And the guy that is doing the commercial comes in and say, I want this song like a Beyoncé song. And of course, you cannot use a Beyoncé song because that's a quarter of a million. So, okay, let's, then you, they use our technology. So what do you have which is similar, but you have a much less publishing and overall synchronization cost less. But here you have somebody who's open. No, it's a music director, somebody who really is looking for something which is purely acoustic. In general, when people look for music, they're not looking for only music, but they look for things which are beyond music.
Does that go against innovation in a way?
No, but I think you need to put more things in the music product than just the audio itself. You need to be a band in your locality, somebody that you eventually can go to a concert. If you can never go to a concert, then it's something. There's more to the music experience. It's very social. If your friends do not know it and you cannot go to the club where they you can listen to the kind of music and you cannot dress the kind of music because you're a punk rocker or because you're a hip hopper. I mean, I think there's more things to music than our naive thing that it's the music itself, and it's not music, it's more.
Katharina Zweig from the Technical University of Kaiserslautern in Germany. So you gave an example where you made a recommendation of shop to something that is very well known, and you said that it cannot be done by collaborative filtering because he was only on 580 playlists. Well, I think that's plenty of statistics, and I would say that yes, you can do it by collaborative filtering. So why did you say that you cannot?
Well, I guess it's because it's very unlikely that you get that recommendation. I mean, it's possible because there's a path that you might find it. So for the collaborative filtering to connect things, all the nodes need to be connected. They need to be part of a giant component. And not all of them are part of a giant component. If they are connected, then you somehow can reach. But then the link is so... Maybe you're connected, maybe this guy is connected through Madonna or through something which is so general that it doesn't provide any meaningful information of the, I don't know, you're connected to the hub, and the hub, you sound like Rem or you sound like Eric Clapton. Okay, no? This might be the link that this guy has. If you are a user and you say, give me something like Eric Clapton, well, Eric Clapton has so many people that the moment you recommend Mike Sharp, I mean, he's at the end of the list. And you don't have any, even though there's a path that collaborative filtering can take you there, if it's not in an island, there's not enough evidence to suggest that this is a good recommendation. I mean, if you do it, that's, I don't know who was saying, putting some randomness in the algorithm, that's putting a lot of, the more, if you're in the head of the, it doesn't have any music semantics, it. You need to be more in the mid so that it's more, you sound like, I don't know, The Cure, something more specific. If you sound like Beyoncé, it's like more general, and it doesn't take you to the, but yes, you're right, you could reach there.
So we're already a little bit over time, but we do it for the live call. And there's one last question.
Hi, I'm Nini Yankowitz, NY Art Projects. Thank you for the interesting work here. Listening to some of the comments, it sort of did dawn on me, which is the nature of this conference, perhaps an interesting another generation of this research would be to collaborate with neuroscientists who have developed interactive ways of through sensor, emoticon sensor, you're sensing people's responses. It's picked up and put into this process of, like, for example, you're saying what's familiarity, certain kind of biological responses are going to feed into it. So it's an additional aspect to the filtering system, which might give another range to it. If I'm
okay, thank you very much.
Thanks,
everyone.